Cool, thank you very much. Yes, it is true. In my start in the morning is normally going out to the chicken house and finding pythons and wrangling the pythons and going and sending them back into the bush. So that's the joys of having a freelance lifestyle and living in the country. So I live up in Mount Tambourine in Queensland and run my business from there. So a bit about me. I am a WordPress developer. I've been in the game since 2008 with WordPress. I generally work with StudioPress's Genesis theme, and I design for business, not for art. So my websites, when I look back at my portfolio, there's some I'm very embarrassed about, and others that I'm really proud of in terms of design. But primarily it's looking at what has this website got to do, what's its main purpose, and how do we achieve that. Prior to this, how I came to this business is that I had a mortgage broking firm in New Zealand, and I built a website back in 2002 and took my small local mortgage broking business from a little tiny agency to one that was doing business nationally across all of New Zealand. And that was primarily on the back of a website, and that's me not knowing what to do. And it was at that stage they're developing a long sales copy website, which was a direct response website, and that just built our database and got us national recognition. So I come to the space as a business owner and someone who's been involved in marketing. I don't come to the space as from the point of view of being a designer or being a web coder. So although that's what I do. But it's the business hat that I wear first, and it's how do we actually have this tool here that's going to generate business for a company. So what I'll talk today about are some real examples. So these are sites that we have built and ones that are functioning and doing really well. So this particular site here, the reason why I've chosen this one is it's probably about 4 years old now. And this site is a building inspector, and he gets about 80% of his business from this site here. So he doesn't do much else by way of advertising, but this site is what provides his business income. So I'm going to run through what are the elements on this that we put together that makes this work in terms of it being a website that generates inquiries from. So like any good website, it has a menu. So today's menu for this presentation is, this is what we're following. I'm just going to run through. It's a really practical presentation. We'll look at the header, the footer, the sidebar, homepage, inner page, problem, solutions, action, and tracking. So these are all the elements that we look at. This is the formula we follow when we're building a website out for business. But before all that, there's a fundamental question that we ask every business, and what's your purpose? So what's the purpose of the website? And there are some interesting answers. A lot of people answer things like, I just need to have a presence out there. Yellow pages aren't doing it anymore. Most of the time, or they want to make more sales, but most of the time they're actually wrong. There's only one single purpose for most of the websites that we build, and that's to generate an inquiry. That's it. So for the business, the phone has to ring. If the phone's not ringing, they're not doing business. Or if they're not getting inquiry forms in, they're not doing business. So that's the metric that we have to see whether this website's successful or not. And if they ring me up and say, the phone's gone quiet, then we need to have a look at the website and find out why it's gone quiet. So that's the only thing they're interested in, and everything else is all superfluous. So the sites we build, the purpose is to get the phone ringing. That's it. So if we look at the header, it's not this head. So here's the top of this particular website. And I should have had a before and after because we rebuilt this one from what it was. The first thing is logos on the left. Eyes track from left to right. So we have our identity on the left-hand side because that's where they start. And They track to the right. What's on the right-hand side? It's the phone number. So where the eye finishes, that's where we want the phone number and a book now button. You'll notice that how many phone numbers have we got up there? Two. So the reason why we have two phone numbers, one's up the very top and one's in the middle there, and there's a purpose for that, is that sometimes people miss one of the phone numbers. So this way we've got an opportunity to make sure they don't miss it at all. So, and when we look at the heat maps of it, both of those numbers do get clicked. The menus there, we've got two menus. One's up the top and one's in the middle. The top menu there is what we call the admin menu, and that's the, like, I don't care menu. So when someone lands on the site here, they don't care about who you are. They don't care about sort of testimonials and those sort of information. They've normally come because they've got a problem and they want a problem solved. That's that second menu in blue there, which is what we call the problems or solutions menu. This is the reason that they're there. And that the purpose of that menu is for them to click on it and take them through to a landing page which has got information about how they can solve the particular problem they've got. The top menu there is really for additional information. Once they've got some idea that this site here or the people behind the site can solve their problem, the next thing they might do is say, well, look, who are these people? So they'll go to the About Us page or they'll go to the Contact Us page, maybe have a look at some case studies or testimonials to see, you know, what other people are saying. But that's not the primary purpose of the site. It's to actually get them in to solve their particular problem. On the right-hand side too, we've got their qualifications, which for most service businesses, they actually have to have that on every page. But it's also a credibility thing. These people are licensed, and that's a credibility statement. You can have other things up there which are boosters, like, you know, fast delivery, your key benefits that are the reason why people might do business with you. And then underneath that there is a slider. Now, one thing I'd say is it shouldn't be a slider. So don't put sliders like that on the website because they... Simply, they don't work. Most of the time, they don't work for business websites. What works better is having say some sort of hero image which is related to the issues that people have. And it's not the issue, but it's the solution or how they're going to feel once it's being solved. So you don't want sort of someone with a sad face up there. You want someone with a happy face that is, you know, their problem has been solved. And again, that's got it's actually got two call to action buttons there. One's get a free quote, the other one's book now. Those two buttons go to the same page. So, and the reason for that is it's a single call to action. That one up the top there, book now, goes to the same page as well. It's a single call to action. And the thing with the pages is that, is not to confuse people, only have one action for the page. Don't sort of have, three or four or five different sort of calls to action which take them to different places. That just confuses them. Just a single call to action. Here's a here's another header of another site. And for this is a mechanic. And just talking with a business owner, the most common reason why people rang him up, apart from wanting to make an appointment to get their car fixed, was to get some directions to find out where they were. So at the very top there, we've got directions. And if you look at the lower one, that's the mobile menu. If you click on that, that takes them straight through to Google Maps. And so on the iPhone, they tap on that, goes through to Google Maps, and they set the direction, and they just they travel. So that's about sort of usability. So this is useful for the end user. The phone number there also, absolute must. It needs to be clickable, so when you tap on it, it activates the phone function on the on your mobile device, so that it's just a single tap and call. So this is your call to action. You want to remove all the any friction points. You don't want them to have to read the number, go to their phone screen, try and tap it in, go back to the website to get the number because they've forgotten the last four numbers, and to tap it in again. So it's all about making it as easy as possible for the end consumer. And there's another one. You see the booking inquiry up on the top right again. So this guy here, is phone calls or bookings. So it's a common thing. So if we look at the footer is something that sometimes for people is an afterthought on their website, but it's a very important piece of real estate because not only do people read from left to right in our side of the world, they also read from top to bottom. And once they read, you know, they get down to the bottom there, it's the footer there is to remind them that they came to the website for a reason, and the links down the bottom, those services there, in this case here, are additional services or expand that. They will go to landing pages of that particular service so they can find exactly what they want. Or the simplest thing to do here is just to repeat what your main services menu was. So it's okay to repeat your menu in three different places, up the top, down the side, and down the bottom. And then in the middle here, we've got additional resources. If we go to this next one, this is actually a better example. And you can see there is a number of menus there, the main menu. And this one's critical here. For this mechanic, they want to know when they're open. So the opening hours are there, where they're located. And there's the Google map there again too, because you know when people are driving, and particularly on their mobile phone, they need to find the directions to the place. And the booking inquiry form, so that book now button that was at the very top, it's also down the bottom of the page as well too, because as people read from top to bottom, we want to repeat that call to action so that they've got another opportunity to take that action. The sidebar, this is a bit like last night. So in this case here, this the services menu is repeated in the sidebar again. So we've got it in the main menu at the top, got it down the side, and we've got it down the bottom. So we're not giving overloading with different information, it's just repeating the same information over and over again. And on the also in the sidebar is the inquiry form. So all of our sites have an inquiry form in the side, and it's on every single page as well, so that you know people are there to make an inquiry. You're just giving them every opportunity to make that inquiry or to make that phone call. The homepage. Who's got welcome to my website or welcome on the homepage? Get rid of it. They're already there. They don't need to be welcomed, and they don't care about your website. What they actually care about is the problem that they've got, the reason why they're there, and getting a solution. They don't actually want to be welcomed to the homepage. It's not, you know, coming into your home. What you want on the homepage is information about, again, the solutions that they're looking for or the problems that they've got. And the best way to do it is, I find, is having junction boxes there. So these junction boxes should be the, if you look at the top three revenue earners in the business. So have a look at, you know, what are the things that actually make the money in the business? Where do they get most of their business from? So the top three things, they go in the junction boxes, because chances are the people that come to the website are probably going to be the ones that are going to be spending money, just like all the other customers are. So this one here, this guy does building inspections, pest inspections, pool inspections. Click on that, goes through to a landing page which just describes that in detail and asks them to make a booking. Here's another one for the mechanic, same thing again. So you can identify these junction boxes either by the primary income earning services in the business or by the customer type. So the customer might be a residential customer or personal customer, might be commercial, or it might be, in this instance, a truck customer. So you could separate them out in terms of customer type or product type. And the best way to sort of think about which one to do is just to test it. See which, you know, you can run both and see which one actually converts better. And here's another example of junction boxes. This particular site is a interior decoration service for hotels, motels, accommodation. So you can see here that we've separated these out by customer types. You know, so bars, restaurants, and cafes, or developers there was about six different junction boxes on this page, looking at identifying people by who they actually were, not the products and services offered. So the other thing about the home page as well is the text on the home page should have have some form of testimonials or reviews on it. So you've got your main content talking about what are the services you provide, what are the solutions you provide, and then also what did other people say about it? Because people don't believe what you say about yourself on the website, but they do believe what other people say. And I know that my partner, her source of credible information that is 100% accurate is to go to Facebook and read the comments on Facebook. You know, for some reason, Facebook has all the answers. I thought it was Google, but apparently it's Facebook. So it's important to have third-party credibility, like your testimonials, and case studies are really important to have there too. So if you've actually done business and you've got a problem that someone's had, you've come in with a solution and they've come in and said how happy they were with that solution or how you solved it for them, particularly if they say how much money you save them or how much time you save them, those are the sorts of case studies that you want on the in the website, because chances are other people are in exactly the same situation and they want to see that someone else's experience is what they want to experience. So, meet Dave. Remember Dave? He was the guy that had a little man in his head there controlling his every action and move. The inner pages here, these are your what we call your admin menu. So these are the ones that they don't care about when they first land on the site, but they're really important. One of the most clicked on pages in many of the websites we've got is actually the About Us page. It's not the Contact Us page or any of those, it's the About Us page. Why would that be? Well, when you walk into a premises, you get to shake hands with a business owner or the people that are helping you. You get to make eye contact with them. And you start to gauge, you know, whether you actually like this person or, you know, and trust them to do business with. That's what your About Us page is. It's a virtual handshake, and it's a means for you to sort of create some sort of personality and connection with the visitors. So, but don't make the mistake of writing the About page all about you. It's still got to be about why would a potential customer, or why would a potential visitor, why would they deal with you and your business? So you're talking about who you are, why you're in business, how you help people, what your philosophy is, what your qualifications are, and most importantly, having a photo. So having your photo up there. Not just a standard headshot, but have sort of something that's personable, that says something about your personality, who you are, and communicates with them that you care or you don't care, but generally that you care, I think, is probably what you want to communicate. And look, it's helpful to have photos of your staff there as well too, so that when someone turns up to their house or outfit or whatever, there's some familiarity that they know the person because they've seen them on the site before. And funnily enough, I had, where was I recently? I was at another conference recently, and someone came up to me and they said, oh no, this is a customer. So I went around to their office and they said, I know you from somewhere. I've never met them before. It's like, I know that I've met you somewhere before. But what they had seen is they've seen my About page, they've seen me on Facebook, they've seen me in various different places. And because my face had been, in various different places, and they'd read some information about me and read some information that I'd written, somehow that created that connection, so they felt like they knew me. Does that make sense? So that's what your About page is all about, is getting that sort of thing so that when you turn up or when they turn up, they already feel like they know you. The other important page, obviously, is your contact page. Whatever you do, don't put an email address on there unless you want lots of spam. So having an email address on your Contact Us page is just a magnet for bots to come along and scrape it and start sending you emails about all sorts of things. But do put your Facebook on there, do put your LinkedIn on there, do put a contact form on there, and do put your phone number on there, and do put your address on there. If you're a physical business, put your address on. If you're not a physical business, also put your address on. Now, if you happen to work from home like I do, I don't want my home address on there. So I've got a virtual office, I guess, which is about this big here, which is a little post box. That's my address, but it's actually got a physical address. So if anyone looks me up, I've got a physical address in Robina, but I don't hang out there. I just go and pick up my checks and mail from there. I only get one check. I get one check a month, which is a real pain. It's for $10.97, and I've got to go down and pick it up every month and go and bank this check. If I didn't have that, I probably wouldn't have the box. But I would still have it for the presence. The reason why you have a physical presence is that if you've got a real address, people think you're a real business. So even in this virtual age, just having that real address means that you actually exist. Oh, sorry, the other pages are FAQ page, frequently asked questions. Think about the questions, best way to get those, what are the questions you get asked on Facebook that you're commonly answering? Have a look at other people's Facebook pages in the same business and see what questions they're asking there. Those become your frequently asked questions page. When I was doing sales, it's also commonly, what are the most common objections that you get? And answer those objections before people ask them, because they're on your FAQ page on the website. Testimonials, look, you don't need a dedicated page to testimonials. The best way to use testimonials is to scatter them throughout your content contextually, which means that if you've just described a product or service or a solution you deliver, put a testimonial or two alongside that, which talks about how good you are at providing that service. So it's better to have them there to support your content rather than having them on a separate page that would, of a whole list of testimonials. They support your content. But case studies do have a case study section there where you take photos and you write up the problems, the solutions you provided, and the benefits that people had with the work that you did. I don't know who's got the problem or the solution here in this photo, but these are your service pages. So you focus on the problem and the solution. You may not necessarily have to give them all of the solution, but you really want to focus on how you're going to help these people. And the best way to, and you do this for every service that you've got. So don't list all your services on one page. List them all out on separate pages and with a good description about what you do. The best way to write up your service pages and your product pages is by a formula by this chap. Anyone know who this is? This is Rudyard Kipling. He had a poem called The Six Wise Men, I think it was. He trusted well, and he took throughout his whole life, and that's to ask the questions. And you need to answer the questions on your page: what, why, when, how, where, and who. So if you're a plumber, for instance, you're answering what do you do, why do you do it, who do you do it for, commercial, residential, when do you do it, 9 to 5, after hours, 24 hours, and how do you do it, what's your process, how do people get in touch with you. So if you follow that formula there, you'll be outstripping all of your other competitors that just put up a website with a paragraph description on it. And then calls to action. On the website, there should be multiple calls to action, but they all lead to Rome. So all of your calls to action lead to one place. That's your inquiry form or your phone number. Don't have multiple ones. You have different calls to action all going to the same thing, as people respond in different ways. This here is fantastic. If you haven't heard of it, talk.to live chat. This is one of the tools that accounts for probably about 10 to 15% of our clients' business. And it's a live chat on the website where someone can come in and they can type to you and you can talk back to them. It comes up on your phone just like a SMS message, and you can respond to them on your phone and they see it on the website. You can also go to the website and see what pages people are on your website, and you can stalk them, and you can say, hey, I see you're on this page here. Can I help you? Would you like to buy this? And it really freaks them out. And lastly, tracking. All this is all good, but it's useless if you don't measure and track what you're doing. So there are some really good tools out there. It doesn't have to be complicated at all, but you just need to know what's going on your website and what people are doing. These are some of the tools that I use. used to be Google Analytics and webmaster tools, but I now use Tag Manager and put all of my tracking codes into Tag Manager. So Tag Manager is reasonably new in Google, but you can put your analytics tags in there, you can put your webmaster, you can put your Facebook tags in there, if you've got Hotjar tags, you can put all of those scripts into your Tag Manager in Google, and your Tag Manager, you only need one tracking script on your website, and that's your Tag Manager. So you don't have to worry about multiple tags in it. And with the Tag Manager, they can track things like button clicks, page views, how long you're on the page. They might record a conversion, so after 5 seconds being on the page, you've got very granular control. The other one's Hotjar. Anyone heard of Hotjar? If you're not using it, go and download it. But you do get a free account to start with. The plugin's in the repository there. What Hotjar does is... I don't have a screenshot, so I've missed it there. That's all right, I'll tell you about it. What Hotjar does is it's heat maps, so you can see where people are clicking on your website and what they're doing and where they're scrolling to. One of the really interesting things was with the heat map, the click map, was that we found that they were clicking on some elements on the website that were not links, that were not taking them anywhere. So what we did was we said, well, if they're clicking on that, they must want more information. So we'll turn that into a link and we'll create a page that they can click on and get more information. So you get some valuable information. Without that, you just would never know that people are clicking on elements that are not clickable. Bitly, this one here is courtesy of Ben, who talked to me about this before. Bitly is a fantastic way of actually tracking, external links there that come into your site. When you send out emails, if it goes out on Facebook or Twitter, where is all your traffic coming from? If you convert this plugin here, will convert your links in your website to Bitly links. So when you post it on Facebook and they click on the link, it will record in the Bitly dashboard. And on your Bitly link, this is the bit that Ben told me today that was really cool, and this is the one reason why I came along this weekend. This is the gem of information I take back. Put a plus sign at the end of it, and you get to see all the stats of where you're where the people are clicking from. And what's even more, if your competitors are using these links, you can find out exactly the same thing on your competitors, how well they're doing with their links as well, just by putting a plus sign at the end of it. So, great little market research tool. Just a plus. So the URL is bit.ly, and then it's got a XYZ123. So that's the actual link. Just now add a plus sign to that when you put it into the browser, and it will bring up that other screen with all the stats on it. Pretty cool, eh? Yeah, well, there is that side of it as well, too. I do have some free stuff, so if you go to this address here, that checklist there, that's that website that we've just spoken about. So that's a checklist of 26 things that we did on this page here. Everything should earn its place on the website. So those are things that we did. This other document here, that's in Google Drive. That's a wireframe. So this is the wireframe that we use to send off to the designers to go and build a site. Pretty much it's the same wireframe all the time. We deal with service-based businesses, and this is what works. So feel free to take it, send it off to a web designer, do whatever you like with it. If you're a designer yourself, take it, use it. And that's me. If you want to contact me, I'm on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, and a website. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, Nick, good talk. I just got one question. You talked earlier about having two call to actions going to the same action. Why do you do that? What's the reasoning behind having two?
So two calls to action going to the same page?
Yep.
Simply because you may have an image with a call to action that really resonates with someone, so they'll click on that one there, but it doesn't resonate with other people. Other people might resonate with just having a button or a text link in an article. So it's like you're giving the same message in different mediums. It's a bit like we've got six senses. We can hear, taste, smell. Your calls to action on your page should deal with all of the or as many of the senses as you possibly can. But ultimately, you want them taking one action, and that's to pick up the phone or make an inquiry. And this one here, I just can't remember the stat exactly, but it was something like it was phenomenal. It was like about a 40% improvement in terms of their conversions. So it was quite significant. And the reason why we did the site is that this guy's sales were declining, his inquiries were declining. He was relying on SEO. The SEO strategies that were being used, some were a little bit dodgy. And so got hit with the Penguin updates, and there were a whole lot of other backlinks in there that shouldn't have been there. So we actually got rid of all those and disavowed those. But then we looked at there were no really strong calls to action, so people got there and they sort of had to find the phone number. So by designing it with clear calls to action there, that sort of got us that, you know, it was around about 40% increase in conversions.
You talked about 80% of his business coming from the website. How did he track that?
It was reasonably empirical in that he just used to ask people, you know, where have you come from? So it was that sort of measurement there.